We are reading in book 11, which only has one long canto, the soul's choice and the supreme consummation. But we've not yet reached the soul's choice. We are with Savitri, exploring the heavens of the everlasting day. And there she has seen the seven immortal earths. Aurobindo described for us the lowest of these realms. But when she looked upwards, she saw there are other, more, even more marvelous realms above. So she moved upwards into the middle regions of the unfading ray. And we had a description of that. And we read about the great forefathers who were moving there, and the seers and poets. So this is still the middle region. There, lightning filled with glory and with flame, melting in waves of sympathy and sight, smitten like a lyre that throbs to others' bliss, drawn by the chords of ecstasies unknown, her human nature faint with heaven's delight, she beheld the clasp to earth denied and bore the imperishable eyes of veilless love. More climbed above, level to level reached, beyond what tongue can utter or mind dream, worlds of an infinite reach crowned nature's stir. There was a greater tranquil sweetness there, a subtler and profounder ether's field, and mightier scheme than heavenliest sense can give. Their breath carried a stream of seeing mind. Form was a tenuous raiment of the soul. Color was a visible tone of ecstasy. Shapes seen, half immaterial, by the gaze, and yet voluptuously palpable, made sensible to touch the indwelling spirit. The high perfected sense illumined, lived a happy vessel of the inner ray. Each feeling was the eternal's mighty child, and every thought was a sweet burning god. Air was a luminous feeling, sound a voice, sunlight the soul's vision, and moonlight its dream. On a wide living base of wordless calm, all was a potent and a lucid joy. Into those heights her spirit went floating up like an upsoaring bird who mounts unseen, voicing to the ascent his throbbing heart of melody, till a pause of closing wings comes quivering in his last contented cry, and he is silent with his soul discharged, delivered of his heart's burden of delight. Experience mounted on joy's colored breast to inaccessible spheres in spiral flight. There, time dwelt with eternity as one. Immense felicity, joined, rapt repose. I think we'll start this side, Suresh, you'll read.
There lightning filled with glory and with flame, melting in waves of sympathy and sight, smitten like a light that probes to other ways, drawn by the chords of ecstasy's unknown. The human nature faint with heaven's delight. She beheld the clasp to her denied and bore. The imperishable eyes of veilless love.
Yes. So this is describing Savitri, how she is feeling. It's as if she's been filled with lightnings. Such brilliant light is within her, filling her up with glory, with some splendid light, and with flame, something very intense and burning. At the same time, she feels that her whole being is melting, like chocolate if you leave it in the sun, or wax melting, in waves of sympathy and sight. You know, all these things that she is seeing, it's as if she's melting, her form is melting into all these things that she's seeing. Sympathy is feeling with, she's identifying with them all. She also feels that she's being played like a lyre. A lyre is a small instrument that poets carry, and they strike the strings as they declaim their poetry. She feels that her body's like the lyre, and there are these strings, and they are being played violently, very, very strongly, by the bliss of other beings. She feels that she's being drawn, attracted, as if cords, ropes are pulling her. Cords of ecstasies unknown. She's being drawn and attracted to new kinds of ecstatic experience. So all this makes her human nature feel faint. It can hardly bear all the intensity of all these heavenly delights. And there it says, she beheld, she saw the clasp, the embrace that is denied to earth that we cannot feel here. We are not allowed to have it in this material world. She saw that, and that must be the clasp, the embrace of the divine. And at the same time, she sees the eyes, the imperishable eyes, the eyes that cannot die or decay, the eternal eyes of veilless love. Nothing is veiling or covering up the wonderful love that is shining out to her from those eyes. Kamala, you'll read.
Lower plunked above, level to level reached. Beyond what Tango can utter or mind dream. Words of an infinite reach crown nature's stir.
Yes. So she sees more and more and more levels reaching higher and higher. And no, he says, no tongue can utter, nothing can describe, no tongue. You can't put into words what she saw there. Mind can't even dream or imagine what it is like. Worlds of an infinite reach. All those levels that she sees are worlds, and they seem to extend infinitely. There seems to be no limit to them. But they are the crown, they are the top levels of nature's stir, it says. I'm convinced this is a mistake. This should be stare. Worlds of an infinite reach crown nature's stare. I dare to say this. That either the scribe has written it wrong, or he hasn't heard properly, because we at the beginning of book two we have the world stare, where it's described how all these worlds and worlds and worlds grow up, and now Savitri has reached, or can look up into, the very highest levels.
I'm thinking of an explanation of stir.
Stir means movement.
So nature has started moving, and it's the top of the nature's work, crown of nature's stirring work.
Then you would expect that he would say something about the calm up there. Here everything is moving and stirring in the lower levels, and there at the crown there's something very, very peaceful and quiet.
I mean effort of nature.
Yes, that's what it means. It means the effort of nature. So you are right in that way. We can understand it like this, that this is the crown of all that stirring and effort of nature. These are the highest levels. Yes. I don't know whether there would be any way of confirming this. I know who I should ask, the person who is in charge of all the manuscripts. He could have a look. But this part was all dictated, so we can't be sure about it. Sarojini, yes?
There was a greater tranquil sweetness there, a subtler and profounder than
field.
And mightier scheme than heavenly sense can give.
Yes. So in those higher reaches, there was a greater tranquil, peaceful sweetness there. And this seems to be the field of a very special atmosphere. Ether is the finest form of substance. So, but this is not the ether, the elemental ether. It is something more subtle, This B is silent. We don't pronounce the B. More subtle and more deep. And these levels, these realms, are carrying out a more powerful scheme, a plan, more powerful plan than even the heavenliest kind of sense can convey to us. Chandra.
Their breath carried the stream of seeing mind from was the tunnels remain of the soul. Color was the visible tone of ecstasy, shape seen of immortal by the place. And yet, voluptuously, palpable, but sensible to touch the
Spirit. Spirit, yes. Their breath. Breath is typical of life, not the life energy. It's the breath. So the breathing there, breathing in and breathing out, it carries with it a stream, a current of seeing mind, a power of consciousness and vision. Form, the form of the bodies. He says it was a tenuous raiment. Tenuous means very thin, almost not there. A clothing, raiment, very, very fine, almost invisible clothing of the soul, so that through the form the soul can be seen or is revealed. There are wonderful colors there, but each of those colors is like a tone, maybe a note in music, an individual, a special tone, a visible tone, it can be seen, a special kind of ecstasy, of bliss. And there are shapes there which, if we look at them, seen by the gaze, they seem to be half immaterial, almost as if they don't exist, a kind of mist. No? But nevertheless, to the sense of touch, they are voluptuously palpable. They give an incredible ecstasy to the sense of touch. Voluptuous is enjoying the sense of touch. Palpable means something that you can touch. So you almost can't see these half immaterial things, but they are felt, experienced. And they make sensible to touch. The touch can sense the indwelling spirit, the spirit who's dwelling inside those half immaterial shapes. Joanne.
The high perfected sense illumined with a happy vessel of the inner ray. Each feeling was the eternal's mighty child, and every thought was a sweet burning god.
So it's as if the power of the senses, which we enjoy in a material way, there it lives full of light. It's been perfected. It's reached its highest state. And it lives as a vessel of the inner ray, the light of the spirit. A vessel is different from a vessel. A vessel is something as a container. A vessel.
Slave.
It's not quite a slave.
No. Like a servant.
It is in a hierarchical order. If you have the king or a lord, then the people that he's looking after and who are working for him, they are his vassals. So it means the sense is happily working for that, in the light of that inner consciousness. Each feeling, any kind of feeling that can come, feeling of the senses or the emotions, it's like a child, a powerful child of the eternal. And every thought was a sweet, burning God. Sweet and very intense at the same time. Sergei.
There was a luminous feeling, sound and voice, sunlight is soul's vision, and moonlight is dream, and a white living place of warm is calm. All was a water and elusive joy.
So the touch of the air is a feeling that's full of light. All the sounds that come are a kind of voice. They give a meaning. Sunlight, the brightness of the soul's vision. And moonlight, its dream. A softer, dreamier kind of light. So there, everything is based on this wide, living base of wordless calm. A calm that doesn't get put into words. Everything is a joy, a potent joy, a powerful joy, and a lucid joy. One that is very clear and full of light. Lela.
Into those heights her spirit went floating up, like an upsoaring bird, pronounced unseen, voicing to the ascent his throbbing heart of melody, till the pause of closing wings comes, quivering in his last contented cry. And he is silent, with his soul discharged, delivered on his heart's burden of delight.
Yes. So she sees those heights, those higher levels above her, and her spirit goes floating up into them, like a bird. And it's like a very special kind of bird. Unfortunately, we don't have this bird here. But we have him in England, in Europe. This is the lark. And many poems have been written about the lark. It's a very small, brown, inconspicuous bird. But if you go into the country on a summer afternoon, you will hear that bird. He sings as he flies up and up. And up and up, you can hear, you can't see him because he's only a small bird, but he's got this lovely voice. He sings as he flies up. So Aurobindo compares Savitri's spirit going up into the heights like that bird, an up-soaring bird, soaring up. He's mounting unseen, you don't see him. But as he's ascending, as he's going up, he's voicing to the ascent all the love and delight that he has in his heart, his throbbing heart of melody. He's singing like mad until he reaches somehow the top of that ascent. And then Sri Aurobindo says, till a pause of closing wings, then he'll close his wings and he'll come down again, no? That pause of closing wings comes quivering in his last contented cry as he finishes his song. Then he doesn't sing anymore because he has sung his little soul out. He's with his soul discharged, delivered of his heart's burden of delight. He was carrying all that delight in him. He's sung it all out. Now it's he's relieved of that, and he comes silently down again. It's a beloved bird in my country and in English poetry. There are many poems about this bird, especially in the early morning. He goes, "Hark, hark, the lark at Phoebus gate sings," I think, in the early morning with the rising sun. A lark, L-A-R-K, lark. So that's how Savitri goes, floating up as if singing. And then he puts it in another way. Slava?
Experience wanting, own dress, coat, dressed, jewel, invisible, fresh, in spiral light, that time dwell in eternity as one. Immense, festive, joint, correct, response.
Yes. So, another way of saying this, that Savitri's experience is going higher and higher and higher, and like a bird with a coloured breast, it's being carried up. Up to spheres, to realms and worlds that can't be reached, but it's going in this spiral flight. And in those inaccessible spheres that can't be reached, time is dwelling at one with eternity. And immense felicity, bliss, delight is joined with repose, with rest, with calm. But this is a calm which is wrapped. It's carried away with rapture, with delight. So that's the end of this first section of Book 11, this long canto, giving us a taste of these wonderful heavens that Savitri has seen. So what comes next? Narendra, you'll read.
As one drowned in a sea of splendor and bliss, mute in the maze of those surprising words, turning she saw a living north and source, key to their charm and fount of their delight, and knew him for the same whose snares our lives, captured in his terrifying, pitiless net, and makes the universe his prison camp, and makes in his immense and vacant vast the labor of the stars a circuit vain, and death the end of every human road, and grief and pain the pangs of man's toil.
Wages
of man's toil.
So this is still Savitri, as if she's been swallowed up in an ocean of splendor, of great beauty, and of bliss. She herself is silent in this maze, this labyrinth. You can't find a way out, this maze of all these surprising worlds. She turns around, and she sees the being who is the center and the source of that maze of worlds. That being is the key to their charm. He opens up their charm, produces it, and the fount, the origin of their delight. And very, very surprisingly, in this being, Savitri recognizes him, this being, as the same one that she's been fighting all this time, the one who snares our lives, captured in his terrifying, pitiless net, in the net of death, that one who makes this universe his prison camp. And in the immense and empty vasts of this universe, in all that outer space, he's the one who makes all this labor and effort of the stars forever whirling with their energy, a circuit vane, a meaningless circling round and round, the one who makes death the end of every human road, and grief and pain, the wages, the payment that human beings get for all their hard labor. You'll read, please.
One who her soul had faced as death and night, as some of all sweetness gathered into his brain, and blinded her heart to the beauty of the sun.
Yes. So she recognizes him as this terrifying being whom she has faced, as death, as night. But now it's as if he's gathered all possible sweetness into his form, into his limbs, and he's blinding in his glory. She can't even see the beauty of the suns and stars anymore. He is so brilliant, so full of light. Ramanarayana.
Transfigured was the formidable shame, his darkness and his sad destroying might, abolishing forever and disclosing the mystery of his high and violent deeds. A secret splendor rose revealed to sight, where once the vast embodied void had stood.
One more line.
Night, the dim mask had grown a wonderful shape.
Yes. So that formidable, that powerful, dark and terrifying shape has become transfigured, completely changed. All that darkness, all that sadness, all that negativity, destroying power, has been abolished forever. And instead he's revealing the mystery of his high, noble and violent deeds, all the things he does. A secret splendor. That splendor has been hidden, but now it is showing itself, rose, revealed to sight, just where that vast, embodied emptiness, that void had stood. And night, that dim, dark mask of night, has grown and is showing a wonderful face.
I'd like to ask you, because I find Aurobindo does quite often this, that, you know, one sentence only and a thought. It's always quite powerful. You know, like,
yes, sure he has written about it, actually. Writing in a letter about his way of composition, he said that in such a long poem, in order to avoid monotony, he had to be very, very careful, among other things, to vary the length of the sentences. So he arranges a mixture. We can notice that sometimes it's longer and sometimes shorter. And he uses these single lines very, very interestingly, usually to finish off something, and the same line begins the next thing. Sometimes he does it in one line, and sometimes he does it in two lines. But you can see that it always comes like a kind of marker that one paragraph is finished and the next one is coming. Oh, well, I'll try to send you the reference to it. Yes, yeah. It's in Aurobindo's, nowadays in the collected works. There's a volume on letters on poetry. And in there, there's a section on Savitri, and it's in that section. But I'll try and find it. So, Gumsun, you would read next.
The babe in print was slain, whose school had outlined from the table unknown. The obscure digestion was pillar of God. Fleet was the air, the arms, the hands of the and life to the ignorant God, whose hollow deeps had given to nothingness.
Dreadful voice, yes. So that vague, formless or indefinable infinity, whose gloom, whose darkness had outlined in front of Savitri from some terrible unknown the figure of a god, the figure of the god of death. The obscure, difficult to see and understand, at the same time disastrous, terrible, catastrophic figure of a god. That is slain, it's destroyed, it's gone forever. And at the same time has fled that error, that mistake, that strengthens, to arm means to give strength to the hands of grief. It makes grief stronger, more powerful. That error lights, gives some light in this ignorant gulf, this huge empty space whose hollow deeps. Hollow means that it doesn't contain anything, no? We have a hollow tree. There's just the outer bark and nothing in the middle. Or you can have hollow promises. People promise you things. Tomorrow, sir, I will come. And they don't mean anything. No? Yeah. Hollow promises. Who had given to nothingness a dreadful voice. She sees that figure she has seen was somehow a product of earth ignorance. And that is the way we see this God as death and the source of grief and pain and terror. Mila.
As when before the eye that wakes in sleep is open, the sound binding of a book, illumined letterings are seen which kept a golden place of thought inscribed within. A marvelous form responded to her gaze, whose sweetness justified life's blindest pain. All nature's struggle was its easy prize. The universe and its agony seemed worthwhile.
Yes. So he gives this image that in a dream we may see a book which has a very dark binding, maybe even black. But then in the dream the book opens up and we see that inside wonderful things are written in gold and brilliant colors. The somber binding of a book. The book is opened and illumined letterings are seen. In the days when people made handmade books, everything had to be written by hand. There were scribes, most of them just did the ordinary black writing, but there were some special artists who were asked to do illumined letterings of beautiful big letters in gold and very precious colors made with precious stones. And he says these illumined letterings are revealing a golden blaze of thought. It's not only that the letters are beautiful, they are expressing wonderful thoughts that are written within this darkly bound book. So she had seen death in this dark form, and now it's as if the book has been opened and she sees all this golden writing inside, and this golden blaze of thought. So responding to Savitri's gaze is this marvelous form, whose sweetness, the sweetness is so great that it justifies the blindest pain of life that we can possibly experience. She feels that all the struggle and suffering of nature was an easy price to pay to see that form, the universe and its agony seemed worthwhile. This is an experience which many mystics have recounted, that when the divinity reveals itself, then suddenly everything that happens in the world makes sense and seems worthwhile. You might see your whole past right back to the time when you were an amoeba, and all the things that have happened. And you, oh, that's what it was all about. It's all worthwhile. Alice.
As if the coric calyx of a flower, aerial, visible on music's waves, a lotus of light-petaled ecstasy took shape out of the tremulous heart of things.
Yes, amazing sentence. A calyx is the, I think it's the part of a flower that contains the stamens and the pistils, the reproductory organs of the flower. It's the body part of the flower, the calyx. But do you see what he's doing? He says that this calyx, it maybe it has this form, but it's choric. It's as if it is made out of the sound of many voices singing. But it's aerial. That sound is carried on the atmosphere. But it's the calyx shape is visible on these waves of music. So this is the form of a lotus of light petaled ecstasy. The petals, the many, many petals of the lotus are made of light, and they are also full of bliss. This is taking shape with this wonderful sound that's coming It's taking shape out of the tremulous heart of things. It's just appearing in sound on the atmosphere, this wonderful form. Ganga Lakshmi.
There was no more Suttavant under the stars. The eagle sheltered behind nature's mass. There was no more the dark pretense of aid. The queer rictus on love's altered face.
Yes. So as that light-petaled lotus of ecstasy takes shape, then all this pain just vanishes. All the torment, all the terrible suffering under the stars that we experience here. And the evil that seems to be hiding behind the mask of nature. Nature may look so beautiful, but actually, as the biologists tell us, it's red in tooth and claw, no? And sometimes now we see these nature films that express exactly what Sri Aurobindo has said about the fear-filled life of bird and beast. It's only when we see it from a distance that we can think nature's beautiful. There seems to be an evil sheltered behind nature's mask. But that doesn't exist anymore. And even this appearance of hate, there was no more the dark pretense of hate, as if hate has no reality. Hate is the opposite of love, a violent opposite, no, of love. It just doesn't exist. It just seems like a kind of pretense, a game. No? The cruel rictus on love's altered face. The face of love should be sweet and loving, but sometimes in our experience, when the person we love is very angry with us, no? A rictus is a kind of disease or spasm of the nerves which makes you grin, but it's a horrible grin because, you know, there's something wrong, you know. A deformation, yeah. Hate, of course, is a deformation of love, yes. But here he says it's just a cruel pretense or a dark pretense. It's not real. Behind, what is behind is really the love. He's going to explain that. You read, please.
Hate was the grip of a baleful and
strife.
Hopeless love intent only to possess. As here replaced the sweeter virtue of God.
Yes, so he's explaining what hate is. Hate, well, she sees that hate is the grip of a dreadful kind of love, a struggling kind of love, no? A love, a ruthless love, a pitiless love which only wants to possess, has here in our world replaced the sweet original God of love. No. Forgetting the will to love that gave it birth, the passion to lock itself in and to unite, it would swallow all into one lonely self, devouring the soul that it had made its own. By suffering and annihilation's pain, punishing the unwillingness to be one, angry with the refusals of the world, passionate to take, but knowing not how to give. This is the distortion of hate that has forgotten that original will which has given birth to love, no? The passion to to unite, to have oneness. It gets distorted into this feeling of wanting to swallow everything into itself, devouring the soul that it's made its love, its own. And so when there's not the response which it expects, it wants to punish instead. Suffering, annihilation, pain, it wants to wipe it out, it wants to punish that unwillingness to be one. Hate comes from an anger with the refusals of the world. It's passionate, but it's passionate to take, doesn't know how to give. So we'll stop there for today.
There, lightning filled with glory and with flame, melting in waves of sympathy and sight, smitten like a lyre that throbs to others' bliss, drawn by the chords of ecstasies unknown, her human nature faint with heaven's delight. She beheld the clasp to earth denied, and bore the imperishable eyes of veilless love. More climbed above, level to level reached, beyond what tongue can utter or mind dream. Worlds of an infinite reach crowned nature's stir. There was a greater tranquil sweetness there, a subtler and profounder ether's field, and mightier scheme than heavenliest sense can give. Their breath carried a stream of seeing mind. Form was a tenuous raiment of the soul. Color was a visible tone of ecstasy. Shapes seen half immaterial by the gaze, and yet voluptuously palpable, made sensible to touch the indwelling spirit. The high perfected sense, illumined, lived, a happy vessel of the inner ray. Each feeling was the eternal's mighty child, and every thought was a sweet burning god. Air was a luminous feeling, sound a voice, sunlight the soul's vision, and moonlight its dream. On a wide living base of wordless calm, all was a potent and a lucid joy. Into those heights her spirit went floating up, like an upsoaring bird who mounts unseen, voicing to the ascend his throbbing heart of melody, till a pause of closing wings comes quivering in his last contented cry, and he is silent with his soul discharged, delivered of his heart's burden of delight. Experience mounted on joy's colored breast, to inaccessible spheres in spiral flight. There time dwelt with eternity as one. Immense felicity joined rapt repose. As one drowned in a sea of splendor and bliss, mute in the maze of these surprising worlds, turning she saw their living knot and source, key to their charm, and fount of their delight. And knew him for the same who snares our lives, captured in his terrifying, pitiless net, and makes the universe his prison camp, and makes in his immense and vacant vasts the labor of the stars a circuit vain, and death the end of every human road, and grief and pain the wages of man's toil. One whom her soul had faced as death and night, a sum of all sweetness gathered into his limbs and blinded her heart to the beauty of the suns. Transfigured was the formidable shape. His darkness and his sad destroying might abolishing forever and disclosing the mystery of his high and violent deeds, a secret splendor rose revealed to sight, where once the vast embodied void had stood. Night, the dim mask had grown a wonderful face. The vague infinity was slain, whose gloom had outlined from the terrible unknown the obscure, disastrous figure of a god. Fled was the error that arms the hands of grief, and lighted the ignorant gulf whose hollow deeps had given to nothingness a dreadful voice. As when, before the eye that wakes in sleep, is opened the somber binding of a book, illumined letterings are seen which kept a golden blaze of thought inscribed within. A marvelous form responded to her gaze, whose sweetness justified life's blindest pain. All nature's struggle was its easy price. The universe and its agony seemed worthwhile. As if the choric calyx of a flower aerial, visible on music's waves, a lotus of light-petaled ecstasy took shape out of the tremulous heart of things. There was no more the torment under the stars, the evil sheltered behind nature's mask. There was no more the dark pretense of hate, the cruel rictus on love's altered face. Hate was the grip of a dreadful amour's strife, a ruthless love intent only to possess has here replaced the sweet original God. Forgetting the will to love that gave it birth, the passion to lock itself in and to unite, it would swallow all into one lonely self, devouring the soul that it had made its own. By suffering and annihilation's pain, punishing the unwillingness to be one, angry with the refusals of the world, passionate to take, but knowing not how to give.